I'm pleased to co-chair this joint subcommittee hearing on the present and future impact of virtual currency with my friend Senator Merkley, and I also appreciate the work that Senator Heller has done. I know Senator Kirk is going to be joining us as well. We're going to do this a little different because this is a joint subcommittee hearing. I will chair the first panel, and Senator Merkley will chair the second panel. The uses of virtual currencies have proliferated in recent years. My hope for this hearing is to educate the Senate members and others and start the education of the public about virtual currencies, including their potential and drawbacks. I also hope to explore how regulators are keeping up with this technological innovation to protect consumers. And I've got a full statement here, but I actually have to acknowledge that, you know, I've been following this kind of development of bitcoins for the last few months, and I think I'm only starting to wrap my head around the potential upside, downside, regulatory issues, monetary policy issues, taxation issues, consumer protection issues that this innovation represents. And rather than going through my whole proceeding, I just will point out to the witnesses and those that back in 1982, I had the opportunity to get engaged in a new industry at that point that was on the cutting edge of innovation called cellular telephones. And all of the experts at that point thought it would take the world 30 years to develop out a wireless network, and at the end of that 30 years, about 5% of Americans would use them. Luckily for me, the experts were wrong. And now these devices transform our lives. Getting it right from all of the regulatory, financial, consumer points around virtual currencies, Bitcoin in particular, could pose as great, if not greater, challenge and opportunity. And what my hope is this will be the beginnings of an effort to come in with open minds, to hear about the potential, but to also hear about the important ramifications around monetary policy, around taxation. Think about the notion with this 21 million bitcoins that could be created, and as we see acceptance, I understand already the FEC has allowed political contributions to be made in Bitcoin. So this is a development that's already in process. But if this becomes a standard currency or tool, it could radically and dramatically transform the role of central banks, monetary policy. It could transform, it has enormous security concerns. So I am very, very interested about this hearing as a member of the Intelligence Committee. I'm concerned as well about the potential abuse of this development. But I think as we see now about somewhere between 10 to 12 million bitcoins that have been mined, and just the reactions yesterday from Senator Carper's hearing, where I believe Bitcoin spiked at over $700 per unit. We're talking about a currency that has already been monetized, and we as policymakers in ways will have to catch up. So I'm very much looking forward to this. Really appreciate my colleagues, in particular Senator Merkley's interest in this. And with that, I'll turn to Senator Heller. We'll go back and forth with just a couple quick opening statements, and then I want to get to introducing the witnesses.
Very good. Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I want to thank you and Chairman Merkley for holding this subcommittee. I want to thank Ranking Member Kirk, and I'm happy that we're having this joint committee. I think we need to have more of these, and with that, I'll keep my statement relatively brief. Today, we're here to learn about virtual currencies and cryptocurrencies, the most popular, of course, which is Bitcoin. While generations of Nevada have mined for gold and silver, copper, today Nevadans can now mine for new virtual currencies on their computer. While these virtual currencies are not yet widely accepted, the number of users continue to grow, and we must recognize that these innovations decentralize digital payment systems. Today, I look forward to learning about the long-term viability and practicality of virtual currencies. I also want to learn how various government regulators interact and with virtual currencies, and which by their design are meant to be independent, of course, of any government. I will end with this note. The Internet is a new frontier of innovation. With every new Internet-based technology, I believe that members of Congress should recognize that we often don't know what these new advancements will develop into. While we must ensure proper safeguards, it is my hope that through hearings like this, we can help maintain an environment that continues to promote new financial technologies and innovative growth. So thank you again to my colleagues. I look forward to hearing all the testimonies from our witnesses. Thank you,
Senator Merkley.
Thank you, and it's a pleasure to co-chair this gathering. I can see by the full room the level of interest and enthusiasm in this topic. Certainly, this is a new technological strategy that has a tremendous number of implications. The wave of innovation is reaching in the world of currency, payments, and money transmission. We've all heard about exciting developments such as mobile payments and companies like Square, which rely on classic banking system payments. This latest generation of technology, which we're talking about today, takes things to a whole new level. With the creation of virtual currencies like Bitcoin and more recently Ripple, we are actually seeing payments transacted entirely with peer-to-peer trust driving the stores of value. Combined with open source code and a public transaction ledger listing every transaction, virtual currencies are truly a completely different animal. Similar to the ways that the last decade's innovations out of the Silicon Valley and Silicon Forest have improved people's lives, I had to throw Silicon Forest in there because that's in Oregon. Developments in virtual currency have real potential to provide value to American consumers and businesses. Lower transaction costs, more secure money transmission. These are significant qualities. At the same time, leaving this space unwatched and unregulated will all but ensure it is full of pitfalls for users and law enforcement alike. We've had recent news about illicit activities, narcotics money laundering. We've had rapid fluctuations in the value of the market for the bitcoins. We have questions about consumer protections. And there are certainly, therefore, a lot of issues about whether virtual currencies are ready for prime time. Today's hearings will explore the current and future state of virtual currency, especially how it affects core financial services that families and businesses rely on to move money and make payments. Where is there potential for innovation opportunity, and where are the gaps and weaknesses along the way? I wanted to note, I have a recent article here called Portland Businesses Enter the World of Digital Currency. Back in 2009, Greg Abbott, the owner of Withy's Fried Pies, was hanging out with a bunch of tech enthusiasts along his food cart. And he was discussing the potential of a then new online currency known as Bitcoin. And one of the folks hanging out, an early investor, offered Abbott 1,000 Bitcoins for one of his hand pies. He says, quote, "I didn't say no. I just got distracted and the individual wandered off." And then he says, "That was a $250,000 mistake, silly me." Well, based on yesterday's value, that's a $700,000 mistake. That certainly would have been the most expensive pie in the history of humankind. This is absolutely fascinating. By the way, he did proceed to start accepting bitcoins, as a number of Portland facilities have done, using a mobile app that converts from dollar, bitcoin to dollar, and back and forth based on the most recent exchange rate. So this is actually a functional, viable technology at this very moment. So with that, Senator Kirk.
Senator Kirk.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Just thank you for gathering us together on this Bitcoin effort. Would say that I have been worried about Bitcoin some, that because it's so complicated, it could it could facilitate illegal activities or terrorist activities.
Thank you, Senator Kirk, and I think that's obviously one of the focuses we'll work on this first panel. Let's get to the witnesses. Let's get to the real experts. The first panel, as I mentioned, will focus on the governmental side. The second panel will focus more from some of the advocates, and I think it'll be an interesting afternoon. We have Ms. Jennifer Shasky-Calvary is the Director of Financial Crimes Enforcement Network, FinCEN, a Bureau of the Treasury Department. Prior to joining Treasury, she was Chief of the Asset Forfeiture and Money Laundering Section at the U.S. Department of Justice. As Chief, Ms. Shasky-Calvary managed a Justice Department program responsible for the annual forfeiture of more than $1.5 billion in criminal assets and related programs to ensure that those assets were returned to victims and reinvested in law enforcement. She has also testified before Congress on a wide range of issues, including transnational organized crime, financial crime, state business incorporation practices, and this one will probably break some new boundaries as well. Welcome, Ms. Shasky-Calvary. Mr. David Cotney, correct, is Commissioner of Banks for the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. He has served in that position since November 2010, overseeing the supervision of over 200 banks and credit unions with assets in excess of $325 billion. Mr. Cotney is an active contributor to consumer protection efforts both in Massachusetts and nationally. In 2013, he was elected as vice chairman of the board of directors of the Conference of State Bank Supervisors, on whose behalf he testifies to here today. Welcome, Mr. Cotney. Ms. Shasky-Calvary, if you could start.
Chairman Warner and Merkley, ranking members Kirk and Heller, and members of the subcommittee. I'm Jennifer Shasky-Calvary, the Director of Treasury's Financial Crimes Enforcement Network, or FinCEN. I'm pleased to be here today to discuss the important regulatory, enforcement, and analytical work we are doing at FinCEN to prevent illicit actors from exploiting the U.S. financial system as technological advances, such as virtual currency, create new ways to move money. Recognizing the potential for abuse of emerging new payment methods and understanding that anti-money laundering protections must keep pace with these advancements, FinCEN began working with our partners several years ago to study the issue. Here's what we learned. Illicit actors might decide to use virtual currency for many of the same reasons as legitimate users, but also for some more nefarious ones. Specifically, an illicit actor may choose to use virtual currency because it provides anonymity, is easy to navigate, may have low fees, is accessible globally with a simple internet connection, does not typically have transaction limits, is generally secure, and provides a loophole from the AML-CFT regulatory safeguards in most countries around the world. Indeed, the idea that illicit actors might exploit the vulnerabilities of virtual currency to launder money is not theoretical. Liberty Reserve engaged in a $6 billion major money laundering operation. And just recently, the Department of Justice alleged that customers of Silk Road, the largest contraband marketplace on the internet, were required to pay in bitcoins to evade detection and facilitate laundering hundreds of millions of dollars. That being said, it's also important to put virtual currency in perspective. It's been publicly reported that Bitcoin processed transactions worth approximately $8 billion over the last year. But by way of comparison, in 2012, Bank of America alone made $245 trillion in wire transfers. Thus, while of growing concern to date, virtual currencies have yet to overtake more traditional methods to move funds, whether for legitimate or criminal purposes. Nonetheless, to address growing concerns, in July 2011, after a public comment period, FinCEN released two regulations which update several definitions and provide flexibility to accommodate payment system innovation, including virtual currencies under our pre-existing regulatory framework. Then, last March, FinCEN issued additional guidance to further clarify the compliance obligations for virtual currency actors covered by our regulations. In short, they're required to register with FinCEN, put AML controls in place, and provide certain reports to FinCEN. It's in the best interest of virtual currency providers to comply with these regulations. Any financial institution could be exploited for money laundering purposes. What's important is for institutions to put controls in place to deal with those money laundering threats. At the same time, being a good corporate citizen and complying with regulatory responsibilities is good for a company's bottom line. Every financial institution needs to be concerned about its reputation and show that it is operating with transparency and integrity within the bounds of the law. Legitimate customers will be drawn to a virtual currency or administrator or exchanger where they know their money is safe and where they know the company has a reputation for integrity. and banks will want to provide services to administrators or exchangers that show not only great innovation, but also great integrity and transparency. The decision to bring virtual currency within the scope of our regulatory framework should be viewed as a positive development for the sector. It recognizes the innovation virtual currencies provide and the benefits they might offer society. Several new payment methods in the financial sector have proven their capacity to empower customers and expand access to financial services. We want such advances to continue. However, those institutions that choose to act outside of the law will be held accountable. FinCEN will do everything in its regulatory power to stop abuses of the U.S. financial system. We have proven our willingness to do just that by using our targeted financial measures under Section 311 of the Patriot Act to name Liberty Reserve as a primary money laundering concern and take steps to terminate its access to the U.S. financial system. We stand ready to take additional regulatory actions as necessary to stop other abuses. As the Financial Intelligence Unit for the United States, FinCEN must stay current on how money is being laundered in the United States so that we can share this expertise with our domestic and foreign partners and serve as the cornerstone of this country's AML-CFT regime. We are meeting this obligation in the virtual currency space as we continue to deliver cutting-edge analytical products to inform the actions of our many partners. The administration has made appropriate oversight of the virtual currency industry a priority, and FinCEN is very encouraged by the progress we have made thus far. Thank you for inviting me to testify before you today. I would be happy to answer any questions you may have.
Thank you so much. Mr. Cotney.
Thank you. Good afternoon, Chairman Warner and Merkley, Ranking Members Kirk and Heller, members of the subcommittees. My name is David Cotney, and I serve as the Commissioner of Banks for the Commonwealth of Massachusetts. It is my pleasure to testify before you today on behalf of the Conference of State Bank Supervisors. I thank you for holding this hearing today to address the risks and benefits of virtual currency. The risks of virtual currency include consumer protection, payment systems, national security, money laundering, and other illicit activities. The potential benefits are also diverse. Speed and efficiency, lower transaction costs, and providing an outlet for the unbanked and underbanked. With these evolving payment technologies, states are exploring the connection between existing money transmitter regulation and virtual currencies. State regulators have long supervised money transmitters to protect consumers and preserve national security and law enforcement interests. State regulators are talking with industry and other regulators about evolving methods of moving funds. This includes virtual currencies, prepaid cards, mobile services, and peer-to-peer transactions. State regulators believe that an open dialogue among regulatory, industry, and other stakeholders is key to accomplishing the goal of determining the appropriate level of oversight and supervision. Emerging payment technologies and alternative currencies are, at their core, about the electronic movement of other people's money. This is not unlike the activities of money transmitters, for which the states have an established structure for regulation and oversight. Licensing is the foundation of supervision, ensuring that businesses in a position of trust are legitimate and accountable. An entity seeking a state license must submit information to verify their credentials, typically including criminal background and credit checks, business plans, financial statements, and surety bonds. State regulators examine money transmitters on an ongoing basis, ensuring that a company does not lose its customers' money and complies with consumer protection laws. Further, states actively examine for Bank Secrecy Act and anti-money laundering requirements, coordinating with FinCEN and the IRS. In addition to licensing and examinations, enforcement is a key part of state supervision. After working with the Brazilian Central Bank and two private banks in Brazil, my division earlier this year found evidence of forgery and ongoing illegal conduct by a licensed money transmitter. Relying on existing state-to-state coordination processes, 37 states were able to ensure that all customers were made whole after we shut down the company. Cooperation has been a hallmark of state supervision, manifested in a uniform licensing system for for all states. Originally developed by the states as a mortgage licensing platform and codified into federal law by the SAFE Act of 2008, the nationwide multi-state licensing system has become an integral part of state supervision for a variety of non-bank financial services providers. Massachusetts and 14 other states currently use NMLS as the licensing platform for money transmitters, and 14 more will start using the system in the next year. To improve the state's ability to use the NMLS for other licenses like money transmitters, I want to note CSBS's support for S-947, which enhances the SAFE Act's protections for confidential or privileged information. To address the rapidly changing technology and payments landscape, CSBS continues to explore policy options for digital issues facing regulators. We look forward to working with Congress and policymakers to continue a collaborative approach to all innovative financial products and services, ensuring individuals and economies are well served. Thank you, and I look forward to answering any questions you may have.
Well, thank you both for your testimony. I will put 5 minutes on the clock and go back and forth. I'm going to pick up on something Senator Heller said, you know, in his opening statement. As I try to, again, wrap my head around this, we have to strike the right balance, since we're talking about here, you know, no governmental entity. So we're talking about here the anonymity that is allowed to take place, the ability to set up these exchanges with very little oversight. If we lay too much of a regulatory burden, we could simply chase these exchanges offshore and still leave Americans unprotected. So I guess my first question for both of the witnesses is, you know, we're talking about this as a currency, but have we really determined even that? I mean, there are some says this may simply be an internet protocol, or is this a security? Have we thought through, or is it a currency? And as we've, from FinCEN, and also David, if you want to make a comment as well, you know, has FinCEN consulted at all with the SEC or the CFTC as you've started to develop your guidance? And then when David, Mr. Cotney, have you answered the question as well, you know, is there any kind of beginnings of an international regime, as you talked about with the Brazilians, how they're categorizing this development?
So thank you, Senator. I'll attempt to take those questions in turn. So first on the issue of is it a currency, FinCEN is the regulator for anti-money laundering and counter-terrorist finance purposes. And so we've never opined and still are not opining as to whether virtual currency is a real currency, a commodity, as those questions are really outside our purview. What we do recognize is that it exists and that it's operating and value is being transferred through the U.S. financial system, and as such we need to protect that financial system from illicit actors. And so we were able to cover it under our pre-existing definitions and regulations, which include the concept of other value that substitutes for currency. So we did not need to take a position. But in terms of have we consulted with other regulatory bodies here, at least federally, and the answer is we have. Again, as a part of our rulemaking and our guidance on our narrow lane and issue, we spoke with FBI, the Secret Service, DEA, ICE, FDIC, OCC, IRS, the Federal Reserve, NCUA, SEC.
And they all have sophisticated opinions on Bitcoin?
Yeah. Now that I'll let them answer. But we did consult with, including CFPB from the consumer fraud perspective. But, you know, we've consulted with all of them as we can. This is a developing and innovative arena. Again, we were lucky to be able to cover it under pre-existing regulations. As we talked to our counterparts abroad, which I think was kind of the last portion of your question, there is great interest by fellow regulators abroad, and as they're trying to get their heads around what is this and what does it mean. Our German counterparts, like us, had fairly flexible regulations in place that they could fit this within pre-existing regulations, and so they've done so. And other countries thus far have been asking us to see what we're doing and why. And finally, I understand the Financial Action Task Force, which is the AML standard-setting body for the international community, plans to take up this topic.
Mr. Connie?
In answer to your first question about the level of regulation, that's exactly what the states are trying to do by working with our colleagues, both state and federal regulators, law enforcement, working with industry, to make sure that we have the appropriate level of oversight and supervision. We have the tools to detect and prevent illegal activity. In terms of your second question on international regimes, I think it's important to note that many of these evolving alternative payment systems are in response to consumer demand. And as we've seen in Europe and as we've seen in Canada and elsewhere, there is a big demand for more real-time payments at lower transaction costs, including the transmission of money from one country to the next. There are many members of Europe and Canada that have embarked on efforts to speed the payment systems. Ours has not really evolved substantially in the last 40 years. So I think now is the time to be talking about this subject.
Well, let me, I'm going to turn this to Senator Kirk, who I know will press on some of the potential for abuse, but I may want to get back some of the folks from Treasury at some point, because I do think there could at least be the potential of serious implications about monetary policy. You know, we have taken, even though with Congress's recent actions, sometimes we seem to be jeopardizing America's status as the reserve currency with some of our, I think, mistakes we've made. But if you think a little broadly, this could, again, have huge, huge implications. So I'm looking forward to further pursuing this. Senator Kirk.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I would just ask Jennifer one quick question. Have we seen any recognized terrorist group ever express interest or actually use Bitcoin for its operations?
So we've certainly recognized the possibility and the vulnerability there. There's nothing in terms of information in the public domain about a terrorist organization expressing such interest or using it, but we would always be more than happy to have any outside briefings to discuss that topic further.
Thank you. Over to you, Mr. Chairman.
Senator Merkel.
Thank you very much. I wanted to ask a couple things related to different forms of crimes that have, quote, crimes that have occurred with bitcoins. The first thing I want to ask is, so there is a centralized public ledger that's encrypted. And so the anonymity is only in terms of, you're not truly anonymous. There is an encrypted version of who owns what. And so one concern about the, if you will, the reliability of currency is whether that encryption can actually be broken. So I want to ask that question. There's some very powerful code breakers in the world, and we certainly have discussions about our own U.S. capability to break codes quite often up here. But the second is, we've had this series of reported crimes. One was a Bitcoin savings and trust which ran a pyramid scheme in Bitcoins. We also had the hacking of a Bitcoin exchange called BitFloor, and as it was reported, 24,000 Bitcoins were stolen. And we had InstaWallet, a wallet provider that was hacked, and they lost 35,000 Bitcoins. These are not small dollar items, given the value of the individual coins. But if maybe you could paint a little bit of a picture for us, how does this all work? I mean, if there is a public ledger that is keeping track of who owns what, then how does one actually steal a Bitcoin?
All right, so in terms of breaking the code and the really powerful cryptologists that are out there, I just don't know the answer to that. I don't know if there is anyone out there that can break the code. It has certainly been represented to us at FinCEN that it's as strong as encryption as exists out there, and so it seems quite safe from that standpoint.
This is prime number trapdoor cryptology?
To tell you the truth, I don't know the type of cryptology that's used, but I'd be happy to take that back and get you an answer. In terms of some of the types of schemes you mentioned, whether it's a pyramid scheme or hacking, probably the most relevant concept that comes up there is the irrevocability of the transactions of Bitcoin. So the idea that when I take a Bitcoin and pay you with that Bitcoin, there's no way for me to get that money, so to speak, or that Bitcoin back unless you choose to give it to me and choose to tell me who you are. And so that can be a great tool for fraudsters in the pyramid scheme sense, or hackers who hack into your computer and are able to get your code that is your half of the Bitcoin, so to speak. So as I understand it, there's a public key and a private key to Bitcoin. I think of the public key myself almost like the routing number on my bank account, and I don't give that to others who might want to send me money, and I'm happy to give that public information. What I'm not going to give you is the PIN that I use to access the ATM in my account, and the private key is like that PIN. And so typically the person holds on to the PIN, and when you, it's only, or the private key, it's only when you put the public and private key together that you now have some Bitcoin that you can actually do something with. And so if a hacker gets your private key, they're able to take your Bitcoin and you can't get it back.
They can modify essentially the public ledger, and then the public ledger becomes de facto record of ownership.
That's exactly right.
Okay. So in okay, let's see if Mr. Cotney has any comments on this.
You bring up an interesting case regarding consumer protections, because as the director noted, these transactions are irreversible. And as a regulator charged with consumer protection, that's what we are interested in every day. The interests of consumers to make sure that their money gets from point A to point B, and that there is someone reliable standing behind that transaction. And that's what we're interested in.
Well, in a few seconds I have left, I'll just say it's fascinating that the system, which is not, if you will, continuously tended, but is in this public space, has been robust enough to hold up for this long without a major flaw that brought the entire thing down. It certainly has attracted the attention of innumerable other programmers around the world asking, well, can we create a similar system? And so thus we are here today. Thank you.
And I would just echo, based upon other commodities where there's a physical presence, you can somehow trace it back. The fact that we're talking about something in the virtual world really has, again, remarkable ramifications. Senator Heller.
Thank you, Chairman. I want to thank our witnesses for being here today. We're trying to grapple with this, trying to figure this out, and we have more questions than answers, so hopefully you can answer some of these questions. But Ms. Calvary, I just want to know, when the first time, when did FinCEN first start to take notice of these Bitcoins and other virtual currencies?
Back in probably 2007 with the e-gold case. It was back then that we put out, I believe it was an administrative ruling talking about e-gold, which was a commodity-backed virtual currency, and even back then put out our view that it fell under the money transmitting regulations issued by FinCEN, and so we've been keeping up with it since that time.
Do you have any idea of what percentage of the current virtual currency users and perhaps businesses that are participating in illegal activities?
We would have no way to know that. What we do know is if you take a currency, a virtual currency like Liberty Reserve, that was an instance where we believe it was set up for the purpose of laundering money, and the vast majority of transactions using Liberty Reserve were to facilitate criminal activity of all types. That's what the Department of Justice alleged. That's what we alleged in our 311 action. With regard to Bitcoin, I think we may have a bit of a different situation. It seems that there's a lot of legitimate users out there, and like any type of payment system, system. It can be exploited by illicit actors, and we have seen it exploited by illicit actors, at least with regard to the allegations made by the Department of Justice in the Silk Road matter, alleging that it was used, Bitcoin was used to facilitate hundreds of millions of dollars in money laundering.
On that Silk Road issue, the FBI seized about 144,000 bitcoins. What does the federal government do with those?
So luckily, that's not an issue that we'll have to deal with at FinCEN. But I can tell you from my past job as the head of the forfeiture program that they will be thinking about whether they can sell those assets.
Do they still have them?
I would have to defer to my colleagues at the Department of Justice.
I want to talk, Mr. Cotney, a little bit about volatility. As we know, last week it was trading somewhere around $400, went up to as high as, I think, $900 yesterday, and finally settled at $600. Why the volatility?
Well, I think that there's a great interest in this particular space. There is, as I mentioned, a demand for real-time payments and lower transaction costs, and one of the means today now that we're looking at is through virtual currency. Certainly at the state level, we have a regulatory regime in place. As I mentioned, we are a consumer protection regulator. We're not an investor protection regulator like the SEC, like the states. So we want to make sure that those consumers are protected. And just like any investment, someone who's looking at making an investment, whether it's in virtual currency or in a stock or a bond investment, they need to do their due diligence.
Do you follow anything that goes on in China and Europe? It's my understanding that they're increasing in volume in other countries. Is there any reason for this? Would you have any knowledge?
I don't have any direct knowledge, sir, no.
Jennifer?
My understanding is in some countries there may be an interest in Bitcoin because it can, where you have a home currency that might be considered extremely volatile itself, Bitcoin might be considered a better place in which to store value. And in other places, it's also considered a good medium for transacting or transferring value. And so if there's not a good internal system for transferring value efficiently, it might be used for that purpose as well.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Senator Hottingham.
In the category of shameless plugs, congratulations on holding a hearing on something that could be a problem later on and is not a crisis right now. It's such a rare moment. the Homeland Security Committee is starting to weigh in on this, and I'm going to take this conversation away from the illegal and to the practical realities of what we're dealing with here. As this becomes, as Senator Merkley suggested, a common method of transmitting goods and services, payment of goods and services, replacing a dollar bill or replacing a credit card, which we know are long-standing methods. There are a tremendous number of challenges by not categorizing this. Now, I notice both of you, especially you, Jennifer, have deferred that, saying, thank goodness we didn't have to achieve that, that result, because we had enough broad authority that allowed us to pursue this. But let's take, for example, a Bitcoin being used to buy a pie. How do you ring that up on the cash register? What's the sales tax on that? How do you record it for income tax purposes? How do you transmit it for purposes of payroll taxes? How do you deal with this when it becomes more commonly accepted method of transmission? And so what I'm saying is it's not just nefarious groups, terrorists and illegal operations that have a potential of really skirting on the edges. It is, in fact, the more commonly accepted it is and the more available it becomes, the more difficult it is for regular kind of regulatory activities to be carried out, especially tax activities. I would like maybe your thinking on whether categorizing a Bitcoin achieves a result so that we then can think about the regulatory regime, or whether we need to create a whole new category and think about this differently. Either one of you can answer that question.
Sure. From an anti-money laundering, counter-terrorist financing perspective, and I'll go broader in a moment, but from that limited perspective, it's not as important. We have similar regulations across different parts of the industry. The idea that they're going to have anti-money laundering controls in place, that they're going to provide certain reports on suspicious activity to FinCEN, regardless of whether it's a commodity or a currency or a security, those basic protections will follow however we define it. So from our perspective, it's not as important. But I take your point. Look, this country and all countries are going to have an interest in protecting consumers and protecting investors and thinking about monetary policy and thinking about taxing. All those things and reasons why we have regulatory and statutory schemes in every country around the world covering these issues. If Bitcoin truly takes off and becomes a serious part of the financial system, then those issues will need to be brought to the forefront. I think there is still a question, and that we can't assume that Bitcoin is going to become the major player that many enthusiasts think it will. It very well might, and far from me to know which way this is going to go. I did hear some venture capitalists speak recently, though, and say that they saw this as a binary investment. This is either going to take off and be the next great thing, it's going to be the cell phone of 20 years ago, or it's going to be a nice experiment that completely fails. And so I think we're waiting to see, and in the meantime, at least at FinCEN, we're trying to make sure that we protect our U.S. financial system from illicit actors.
Senator, I think you rightly pointed out the differences between legal activity and illegal activity. Illegal activity, and we can't be distracted by this, is illegal no matter what the means, whether it's paid with, you know, paid for by cash, paid for by ACH.
Guns.
Or exactly, or through now virtual currency. On the legal side, those actors who want to play by the rules will work through, you know, agencies like mine, will play by the rules set by FinCEN, and that's really the importance of a comprehensive set of regulations, both on the state and the federal level.
Just to follow up on a comprehensive set of regulations, you tell me, I'm now the state tax commissioner, and someone paid in a Bitcoin, and I call you up because I find out you have expertise, and I say, okay, just heard that this thing's trading for $700. Is that what the pie's worth? Do you think you'd come down and be my expert witness when I collect sales tax on $700?
Well, fortunately, I'm not the tax commissioner.
I used to be. And so, I mean, this is going to be a big challenge. And my point is that we can focus on the illegal part of this, but to the extent that it becomes recognized as a valid method in the perfectly legitimate commercial world of transferring goods and services, this is going to become an increasing problem. And the more the opportunity presents itself to evade, not illegally, but to avoid taxation, to say that actually was speculation, so are you going to pay capital gains on it? I mean, it's a really interesting challenge, and I think we need to be thinking about these issues if in fact we see this becoming a way to transmit goods and services that's more generally and regularly accepted.
I think you raised a great point, and since many, you know, we point here to today's focus on nefarious schemes, but since it seems from, as I learned about this, a lot of folks who are interested lack trust in central banks, you know, want to be kind of, in fact, off the grid. Huge, huge number of questions. Senator Moran.
Mr. Chairman, thank you. Thank you both for being here. Earlier this afternoon, I posted on Reddit this hearing topic and asked Kansans in particular to comment on what I should know, what would be some suggestions for questions that they might have. And interesting, in just the last few hours, 125 responses, most of them very long and thoughtful. Mm-hmm. Let me explore one of the topics that was raised, and in a sense it's regulatory arbitrage. Is there an effort to make certain that the regulations are uniform globally? And in the absence of that, is there not a risk that the activity is simply taken offshore? If we're the country that is the regulator, and is there an economic consequence to that happening? What's the downside to our country and its economy and the opportunities for innovation if the United States is the heavy regulator and other countries are not?
Sure. Maybe I can take that from both the domestic perspective and then the international, because here, of course, in the United States, we have the states and we have the federal regulation. We do, I think, a fairly good job, as Mr. Cotney mentioned in his testimony, of the states working together to try to find common approaches whenever possible, and then with FinCEN to work with the states on the federal approach and try to get as much common ground there as we can, so that we have as much consistency as we can, at least within the United States. Then we go externally. Externally, at least from the money laundering and counter-terrorist finance perspective, the Financial Action Task Force is the international standard-setting body that attempts to keep consistency in standards across the globe. And it's a body that has both carrots and sticks, and it's been fairly effective in getting countries to put regulations in place. But all that being said, I think if businesses are going to leave the United States based on perceived or real regulatory burden, I think they're going to find the gain short-lived. Because as mentioned, countries are going to have an interest in figuring out the tax implications in monetary policy. It's not just the United States that has an interest in these things and in protecting consumers and investors and so forth. So the regulation is going to catch up. And I think there are plenty of good reasons to bring innovative business and keep innovative business in the United States.
I think it's very important to leverage the strengths of each of us, the state regulators and the federal agencies. At the local level, as a state regulator, I know, for example, that that there's a large Cambodian population in Lowell. I know Lowell, Massachusetts. I know that there is a large Brazilian population in Framingham. I send examiners out every day to conduct examinations, to do transaction testing actual transactions of money going abroad. So we have the boots on the ground and a local understanding of these companies. And then we pair that with the national perspective and knowledge of federal agencies who also interact on an international level. By leveraging these strengths, I think we do a much better job at detecting and preventing this illegal activity.
I appreciate both those answers. Do you have a sense about the importance of this activity being centered in the United States? What is it that, this is a broader question than a regulatory one, but what benefits does our economy and our innovative environment gain by encouraging or at least not discouraging the Bitcoin from being centered here?
So I think what we gain is our continued reputation and economic advantage as being the country where innovators come to start new businesses, and that gives us great economic value something we would want to continue. So I think the great challenge for the regulators are to encourage innovation wherever we can and put smart regulation in place that tries to deal with risks, very real risks about which we need to be concerned, but minimizes burden on innovation.
You know, clearly the United States, you know, the mother of invention, we want to take advantage of innovation, and to the extent that we see innovation in this space, that could have spillover effects into other payments or other financial industries or even beyond the financial services industry. So we want to be able to encourage innovation and have it developed here locally.
I appreciate that. Mr. Chairman, thank you.
I think we've all got a lot more questions for you, but we understand a vote will be held around 5, so we want to make sure we get to the second panel. I want to thank you both for your testimony and look forward to continuing the dialogue.
Thank you for the opportunity.
Thank you.
And I'll turn to Senator Merkley at this point, and he can go ahead and maybe start introducing the next panel.
So because of the time, I'm going to start introducing as you come up, so feel free to take your seats quickly. I'll start with Paul Smoser. He's the president of BITS. BITS, in this case, I do not believe has any relation to the term Bitcoin. BITS is the Technology Policy Division of the Financial Services Roundtable. Mr. Smoser joined the roundtable in February 2008 as vice president of security.
In this role, he led BIT's work in promoting the safety and soundness of financial institutions through best practices and successful strategies for developing secure infrastructures, products, and services. Second, we have Professor Sarah Jane Hughes. She is a university scholar and fellow in commercial law at Indiana University's Maurer School of Law. For the past 25 years, Professor Hughes has regularly taught payments law, commercial law, and banking regulation at the Maurer School of Law. She is a nationally recognized expert on payment systems, public and private methods to detect, deter, and prosecute domestic and international money laundering, and consumer protection and financial privacy. Next, we have Mercedes Kelly Tunstall. She is a partner at Ballard Spa and the practice leader of their privacy and data security group. She has substantial experience working with clients to develop new financial products and services, including virtual currencies. She also works with clients from a spectrum of industries on mobile and other e-commerce initiatives, privacy and cybersecurity issues, and the use of social networking sites for marketing, consumer service, and crowdsourcing purposes. And we have Anthony Galipi. Anthony is the co-founder and CEO of BitPay, an electronic payment processing system for Bitcoin. Mr. Galipi founded BitPay in 2011. He has 15 years of experience in sales and marketing, working in the robotics industry. Before founding BitPay, Mr. Galipi was district sales manager at Aerotech and regional sales manager at Industrial Devices Corporation. So, Paul, we will start with you. Thank you to all of you for bringing your expertise to bear on this topic.
Thank you, Chairman Merkley and Chairman Warner, Ranking Members Kirk and Heller, and members of the subcommittees for the opportunity to testify today. My name is Paul Smoser, and I am the President of BITS, the Technology Policy Division of the Financial Services Roundtable. Attempts to develop digital currencies have existed for decades. As consumers have become more comfortable with Internet financial activity and computer systems have become more powerful and less expensive, we are witnessing the viability of digital currencies increase. However, we need to recognize that digital currency usage exists outside of traditional currency, financial accounting, and payment systems. In my testimony today, I will address both opportunities and risks in the environment. One measure of a currency's success is its acceptability. We are beginning to see select retailers accepting digital currencies for goods and services. For example, the web publishing service WordPress accepts Bitcoin as a form of payment. Just last week, the Federal Election Commission indicated it is considering allowing Bitcoin's use as in-kind contributions. Merchant and government agency acceptance will establish these currencies' legitimacy and increase the trust parties have in them and their stability. Digital currencies also allow merchants access to new consumers in countries where traditional payment systems do not permit access. The lack of interchange fees and chargebacks also appeal to merchants. Digital currencies may also have the ability to provide access to the underbanked and unbanked. For example, a mobile phone-based money transfer and microfinancing service in Kenya called M-Pesa recently added a Bitcoin payment option for its customers. Digital currencies can also help individuals in countries with repressive regimes to support causes they might otherwise not be able to support through their country's traditional payment providers. They can also serve as a potentially stable currency in countries whose own currencies are in distress. For example, during the recent Cyprus financial crisis, citizens transferred funds to digital currencies. Another interesting aspect related to certain digital currencies is cryptographic protections, which some providers claim prevent counterfeiting and duplication. Digital currencies and the supporting infrastructures do present opportunities to watch, including facilitating real-time payments, particularly those involving international parties and those involving micropayments, possible deeper cryptographic options for internet-based transactions, and opportunities to serve the underbanked and politically repressed more effectively. While there are opportunities, we also have to recognize the potential risks. First, as noted, digital currencies pose significant market risk. Without government funding or support, digital currencies are often subject to significant market volatility, creating risk to both holders of the currency and to merchants and others who accept the currency as payment. Beyond the March 2013 guidance issued by FinCEN, the digital currency environment incorporates virtually no existing regulatory protections, particularly consumer protections. For example, and also as noted, within the last 2 months there have been multiple reports of currency disappearances from various Bitcoin trading platforms. In none of these cases is it likely that the owners will recover anything. The lack of consumer protections extends to other areas such as liability limits for fraudulent or unauthorized payments.
Currently, none of the digital currency operators or infrastructure providers is subject to regulatory oversight applied to regulated financial providers, such as the Gramm-Leach-Bliley Act's cybersecurity and data breach notification requirements, the Federal Financial Institution Examination Council's regulatory guidance, or often to independent regulatory examinations. Given the anonymity of the digital currency world and the lack of know-your-customer requirements that apply to traditional financial institutions, using digital currencies, individuals may also be able to donate to illegal organizations that would otherwise be legitimately banned, such as those engaged in terrorist financing. Some recent studies, as we've been discussing, suggest the anonymous nature of digital currencies has made them a haven for illegal activity. We talked about Silk Road and we talked about Liberty Reserve, but those, I think, are probably just the prime examples of the point that criminals are using digital currencies to assist in a broad array of criminal activities. So as we look at the lack of regulatory oversight, the risk to consumers, and the market risk associated with digital currency, there is a continuing challenge to their overall legitimacy, usage, and endorsement. In conclusion, clearly the use of digital currencies will continue to evolve, and there are opportunities to explore, but we will need to address both the concerns to consumers, to society, the need for appropriate regulation, and the effectiveness of risk mitigations. Thank you for your invitation to testify to the subcommittee, and we look forward to continuing to work with you.
Thank you. Professor Hughes?
Ranking Members Heller and Kirk, and honorable members of both subcommittees, I am honored to be here with you today. Monitoring the developments in digital currencies and taking a responsible approach to their regulation reflects their growing presence in domestic and international transactions. Recent negative publicity associated with law enforcement actions against Silk Road and reports of the disappearance of Bitcoin exchange values in China and the Czech Republic raises important policy concerns. I have, as the chairman said, worked in areas that are like this for a long time, not as a provider, but as a watcher. And I also wish that my late father could be here today because he served in World War II as a cryptographer for the United States and was early involved in the computing industry in the United States. I remember being a teenager when he brought home two big briefcases and he said, "It's a computer." And it was. So one of the things is that we're seeing in a relatively short period of time important path-breaking changes in technology of the characters that Senator Warner suggested earlier, and we need to be very cautious not to chill those innovations, but we still need to have appropriate legal regimes around them. And I think it's important that we take some time and craft those legal regimes with great care and in as flexible a way as possible, particularly with regard to the remarks of Director Calvary and Commissioner Cotney. So I had a number of recommendations that responded to the questions that the invitation to appear put forward, and taking them slightly out of order from my prepared testimony, obviously there has already been some support for the idea of retaining the current division between the states and the federal government for portions of the role that each do very well, and I share those views. Second, I think it's incredibly important that we enforce our anti-money laundering, anti-terrorism, and economic sanctions laws, and as a corollary, I also believe that customers of programs such as Bitcoin and other virtual currencies that may develop should get the same federal protections that people get under Gramm-Leach-Bliley, under the Right to Financial Privacy Act of 1978, et cetera. I think FinCEN has taken important steps toward clarifying the application of their existing authority. And I think we need to continue to clarify, particularly so that banks and investors don't get cold feet, because we have no way of knowing today what second stage innovations that may have completely different roles in our economy these new technologies may offer us, and we want to be certain we don't do anything to take them offline. I would encourage on an interim basis payment systems operators, assuming that we all agree that this is a payment system and not something else like commodities or securities, to adopt and publicize their own transparent standards of how they will behave. As you suggested, legal liability limits, dispute resolution possibilities, guarantees for redemption opportunities, and clear rules about when redemption can happen are all important user protections. Notice I said user and not consumer, because businesses who use have many of the same needs as consumers, and we tend to be focused on regulating for consumers. I spent lots of my life looking at consumer issues, but I'm equally interested in businesses being protected. I think we need to leave room for depository and non-depository providers to innovate in the virtual currency space. And so we want a regulatory climate, we don't want a regulatory climate, rather, in which early entrants can freeze out later ones. We'd like to have a lot of innovation in all of this space. I worked at the Federal Trade Commission many years ago, and one of the projects I worked on was the rescission of a number of 1940s and 1950s trade regulation rules that had essentially been written by industries for themselves. We'd like not to see that again, because they can be very anti-competitive, and if they're anti-competitive, they're very anti-consumer. So we need an open set of rules. I'm going to run out of time, but I would say that the other thing is, don't buy the Wild West argument. Just because something is new doesn't mean it should not be regulated on the same basis as the types of activity with which it competes. Thank you so much for this invitation. I'd be delighted to answer your questions.
Thank you very much, Professor. And now Ms. Tunstall.
Chairman Merkley, Ranking Member Heller, and members of the subcommittee, I am Mercedes Kelly Tunstall, a partner at Ballard Spahr here in D.C., and I am the head of our Privacy and Data Security Group. My testimony today reflects my personal experience with the virtual currency industry and represents my own opinion. It does not necessarily reflect the opinions of Ballard Spahr or our clients. Thank you for this opportunity to testify about the present and future of your impact of virtual currency. I currently work with a number of clients on financial innovation issues, and one of the things, as I've been listening to the testimony today, that I feel like it's worth saying is that one of the things that I often say with financial innovation is there's a tendency to say, well, it's completely new. It's so new, we've never seen anything like it before. But the fact is that it is like a lot of things that have happened in the past. So I'm going to go through some of the statements that I have in my testimony, but let's start with the discussion of currency generally in the United States. So the United States actually has a long history of having concerns around currency. It finally settled down in the 1870s when the Supreme Court had a series of opinions called the legal tender cases. And basically what they said at that time is, we're going to stop all this different stuff with the currencies happening. We're going to say there is a U.S. currency, and the rule is everyone in the United States has to accept that currency. So there could be other currencies. You can accept other currencies, but you have to accept U.S. currency. It is the currency of the land, etc. So that's the basis that we're working from. And we do actually have a long history, long legal precedent that talks about how to handle different types of currency in our financial ecosystem. Having said that, when we take a look at Bitcoin and the lessons that we can learn from Bitcoin, and I want to point to where we can talk about a bit of their failures. The first point is that Bitcoin was really designed to not integrate with our existing financial ecosystem. It was designed to be its own thing and try to, you know, break apart the world without working within the practical realities that we have today. And as a result, financial institutions, especially in the United States, view Bitcoin and other types of virtual currencies as being unreliable. Getting involved into them affects their safety and soundness concerns, and so it really is something that right now, not much interest in. The next point that Bitcoin really focused on is that the transactions need to be anonymous. There's this sense that because it's virtual currency and we're trying to remake a cash transaction, it has to be anonymous. But if I'm going to take a dollar bill and hand it to you, I have to see you, and I know the personal information about you, at least some personal information, what you look like. So in the virtual currency world, there is no need for the currency transactions to be anonymous. It can be. The other two elements that Bitcoin addressed, besides anonymity, is taking out the middleman, so the bank involvement, and not having a record that has personally identifiable information in it. So I would say that in order to address the excesses that we are seeing with virtual currencies, where it is being used by criminals and terrorists and money launderers today, we do know that that is occurring, that the anonymity part of it, let's let that go. The whole point should be keep that middleman out of it, if that's what the virtual currency, and there are lots of reasons, we've had lots of people talk about the value that a virtual currency could have, keep the middleman out of it, and we do have the technology today to make it possible that there is not a record with personally identifiable information for others to see, but it is something that is retained by the two parties involved in the transaction. Finally, Bitcoin has caused some of its own problems because it has this commodity aspect to it. And you could design, and some of the other virtual currencies out there have specifically been designed to avoid the boom and bust cycle that we've heard about today. And so those are the three points, really, that we can learn from Bitcoin to allow virtual currency innovation to continue. In terms of looking at what has to happen from a legal perspective, I'm just going to mention we do need to come to what a definition of virtual currency is. Is it a commodity? Is it a commodity or security or not? We do need stronger FinCEN guidance as virtual currency develops. And then finally, on the consumer protection side, we touched briefly on the unauthorized transactions issue. That issue also needs to be addressed and considered. Thank you very much for the opportunity today, and I'm happy to take any questions.
Thank you very much. And now we're going to turn to Anthony Galippi, co-founder and CEO of BitPay.
Great. Thank you, Chairman Merkley and Warner, ranking members Heller and Kirk, and distinguished members of the committee for the opportunity to speak today. My name is Tony Galippi, and I'm the co-founder and CEO of BitPay. I appreciate the members for their interest in the commercial and international trade aspects of digital currencies, and more importantly, the opportunities for digital currencies to create jobs in America and to increase America's exports. Our company, BitPay, was started in May 2011. We've been operating for over 2 years now, which makes us pretty old in the Bitcoin space. During this time, we've acquired over 12,000 merchants to accept Bitcoin using our service. Our merchants include many small and medium-sized businesses in every state who accept Bitcoin side by side with credit cards and other forms of payment. Most online payments today are made with credit cards, but credit cards were never designed for the internet. Credit cards were designed in the 1950s, and last year over 12 million people became victims of identity theft, mostly from shopping online. Businesses lose over $20 billion a year due to payment fraud. The banks don't take responsibility for the fraud. If you're a business, it is your fault that you took a stolen credit card, even if the bank approved it. And credit card fees are discriminatory. The highest fees are paid by the smallest mom-and-pop businesses and the lowest income consumers. Bitcoin is a cheaper, faster, and more secure payment system with no discrimination against smaller businesses. At BitPay, our role in the Bitcoin ecosystem is very close to that of the traditional merchant acquirers in the credit card space. Our software helps merchants clear and settle transactions over the Bitcoin network. BitPay has a strict Know Your Customer policy to verify all of our merchant applications. We need to know who our merchants are and what they're selling. We only want the good actors using our service. BitPay also follows all Bank Secrecy Act guidelines to prevent, detect, and report suspicious activity. Our strict policies to comply with laws and protect our brand have earned BitPay the reputation as a leader and well-respected company in the payment space. Bitcoin does have some limitations that will keep it a small player in the payment space for quite some time. Compared to credit cards, for example, Visa's payment network can handle 20,000 transactions per second worldwide. Bitcoin can handle 7, not 7,000, 7 transactions per second. So even though it's very small, Bitcoin has invented something pretty amazing. With Bitcoin, it is now possible to transfer an asset remotely and immediately settle the transaction with no counterparty risk. That type of instrument has never existed before. And the possibilities of this instant worldwide settlement are very interesting. The Bitcoin blockchain, which is the public accounting ledger of Bitcoin, is a large property rights database. It can handle quadrillions of individual asset accounts with a full chain of custody every time an asset is transferred from one party to another. If you want to energize the housing market, think of Bitcoin. The biggest upfront costs for consumers trying to buy a home today are the closing costs, high fees for deeds, titles, stamps, insurance, and other redundant tasks to record the sale in different record books. Bitcoin can replace thousands of dollars in closing costs with a single transaction that costs 5 cents. Bitcoin does have risks. Criminals use cell phones, criminals use email, criminals use dollars, and criminals use banks. Many businesses like BitPay, offering innovative services on top of Bitcoin, share the committee's goal to protect consumers from fraud and keep the criminals away from our businesses. Guidance from the IRS, Treasury, Justice, and SEC have all established that Bitcoins are legal, and those dealing with them must follow the existing tax laws and anti-money laundering regulations. In the early 90s, when the Internet was in its infancy, Congress took a wait-and-see attitude to let the Internet develop. So where would social media and other free applications of the Internet be today if in the 90s we required licenses for the Internet and we taxed Internet access as if it was a telecom? In 95, the National Science Foundation lifted its strict prohibition of e-commerce, and immediately companies like Amazon, eBay, and Dell were born. Americans will benefit from a similar openness and wait-and-see approach to Bitcoin. Bitcoin is a technology with tremendous cost savings for businesses and consumers. Bitcoin is a more secure, faster, and more affordable option for transferring funds. If America is the leader in Bitcoin technology, America will create more jobs and more exports. In conclusion, today Bitcoin is in its infancy. It's much like the Internet of the early 90s. If we look 10 to 20 years in the future, we will see many companies built upon Bitcoin-related technology, and we want those companies to be based in America, creating jobs in America, and building a revenue base and a tax base in America. I commend the committee for realizing and recognizing the real practical uses for virtual currency, and thank you for the opportunity to speak today.
Thank you very much. And we're going to jump right into questions, and given we have 16 minutes and four of us, I'm going to ask 4 minutes to be on the clock. And I'm going to take my 4 minutes now, and I have three questions, so I'm going to try to move them quickly and see if I can get through all of them. First, Mr. Galippi, what is your transaction fee?
So our transaction fee when we first started was 1%. So compared to credit cards, or around 3%, we're 1%. But we realized very quickly that our marginal cost to do a transaction is low. So we've actually switched over to a software as a service pricing model. Different features and different levels of service. Merchants pay one monthly fee, then they can transact all they want with no transaction fees.
So I've got Wiffy's out in Oregon that says it likes to accept Bitcoins because it has 0.1% transaction fee. Do any of your transaction fees go that low?
Possibly. Well, if you take our monthly service and divide it by the volume that you put through, you could get something that low. That's correct.
Okay. That's fascinating. Thank you. Professor Hughes, I recently read the book The Wolf of Wall Street, and I think this is coming out as a movie soon, but this a broker makes a lot of money, and at one point this is a true story, he has his wife's aunt strapping money and taking it to Switzerland to put into Swiss bank accounts. Are Bitcoin wallets, like Instant Wallet, going to replace Swiss bank accounts?
I don't know the answer to that question, but I'd be delighted to speculate about it for a second. So there are two ways that you could store anything you want, including Bitcoins, right now on a private wallet. The trick is that it'd be harder to transact business that way. So most people who do it use exchanges. But there are so many ways in which one can store value, which could have included in the past putting it on stored value cards, and loading them and taking them to Switzerland and not even needing to do that. So the answer is, yes, technically you can, and yes, technically they could be. And I think that that's one of the reasons why rigorous and clear guidelines for how our anti-money laundering, anti-terrorism, economic sanction regimes are applied to virtual currencies, not just bitcoins, but those that may come in the future, are very important to us. We really don't want to facilitate hiding money, and we do want to be very careful that we protect people who are using currencies of this kind in war-torn areas or areas in which the governments are not reliable or the banking system is not like ours.
Thank you, and I'll follow up with some questions about the Electronic Funds Transfer Act and issues that may arise there, but I want to use my last minute to get to this question. Mr. Galipi is talking about these very low transaction fees, which will make many of my merchants in Oregon, their eyes light up. And as we think about this, this actually, not Bitcoin by itself, because we have a limited number of Bitcoins under the structure it's created, it has security issues, but the concept in general poses some interesting models that could be significantly change our credit card system, our bank deposit system, our debit card system. And Mr. Smoser, in your role with the financial services world, can you give us a little insight on kind of the current thinking of those challenges?
Sure. I actually like the way you characterized it, because when I think about Bitcoin, we kind of tend to use it as a generic term, but in reality, at least for me, it really is three things. It's a currency, potentially, or a security. It is, secondarily, the way we use it, a depository system, so the wallets and whatnot. And third, it is a payment system. So we're talking about kind of three different realms that I think we need to think about individually. Mm-hmm. I do think that it, as I mentioned in the testimony, it has value in showing us that there are ways that we can make the payment system more rapid, we can perhaps make it less expensive, we can make it more available to the unbanked and in some cases to people who might not otherwise be able to use a payment system. But I think, having said that, I think without the consumer protections that we think about in traditional systems, there are a lot of risks to those users as well. And, you know, if I could go back actually to answer your question that you posed to Ms. Hughes as well, I'm not sure you even have to move money to Switzerland in this case, because to me, the anonymity that is associated with users and their wallets would suggest I really don't need to try and cover who owns the money. So.
Thank you. I'm out of time, so we're going to pass this on to our ranking member.
Thank you. Mr. Galipi, I have a couple questions for you. I'd love to be at your home as you're explaining to your wife how your virtual company gave you a virtual paycheck using virtual money. But that being the case, I assume your business wants more consumers than investors.
Well, actually, our business model, and I've detailed it more in my written testimony, we are just a merchant acquirer. So we only facilitate the payments for merchants. We don't have a consumer wallet. We don't offer an exchange for consumers. So we're strictly focusing on business acceptance and business adoption of Bitcoin. And the rules and regulations around that are fairly well defined, you know, in the credit card space, and our business model is very similar to them.
I'm just wondering what would happen if someone like Senator Warner cornered the market of virtual coins. How would that impact the consumer marketplace?
Well, it's interesting. You know, we look at Bitcoin being traded in open markets today, and China is getting very aggressive in the open market. And if we want America to remain a leader in technology and in Bitcoin, you have to look at the exchanges, because that's where all the liquidity is. And right now, the number one exchange in the world for Bitcoin is in China. The number two exchange is in Japan. Numbers 3, 4, and 5 are in Europe. Number 6 is in Canada. America is not a leader right now in the liquidity and the exchange of Bitcoins.
You talked a little bit earlier in your testimony about vetting these businesses. What is that? What do you have to do?
Well, I mean, it's modeled really around the credit card system. You know, what does it take to get a merchant account with a credit card processor? We've modeled our system after that. So we need to know that, A, you're a legitimate business. We need to know who you are, and we need to know what you're selling. And then depending on the different levels of volume that you want to process with, we'll go even deeper into getting background checks and that kind of thing.
Ms. Tunstall, if virtual currencies become more and more popular, what keeps a bank from starting their own virtual currency?
Absolutely nothing, except that, like I said, they do have to maintain their safety and soundness concerns, and a U.S. bank needs to be very focused on U.S. money. But there's nothing to stop a financial institution from getting into virtual currency themselves.
Are you familiar with other virtual currency?
I'm sorry?
Are you familiar with other virtual currency besides Bitcoin?
I am, yes.
Can you share some knowledge?
Sure. So there are a number of virtual currencies that are designed for very kind of niche purposes, that are designed for online video gaming type situations, so you can play with your partners across in China and Japan and wherever. So there are a number of those types of virtual currencies. There are also a number of virtual currencies that are based on Bitcoin and try to basically fix some of the issues that I detailed in my testimony here today. And then there's also a virtual currency called Ripple that has started very differently from Bitcoin and started with the premise we are operating in an existing financial ecosystem and we need to be able to comply with the criminal laws and the anti-money laundering laws that are in place.
Thank you. Thank you, Ms. Chairman.
I'm going to try to go through the lightning round as well. First of all, I don't want to overuse my telecom analogy, but just as we saw in developing countries in many ways, as they develop telecom networks to skip the wired system and immediately go to wireless, wouldn't those regimes that have either huge currency restrictions or enormously underbanked, couldn't you actually see initially the development of these virtual currencies actually quicker and faster in the underdeveloped world than in the developed world? If we get quick responses, because I got two or three more questions.
So my quick response on that is one of the reasons that virtual currencies in the United States have actually proliferated and succeeded is because of the strength of our financial system security. And so for these other countries where there is not that kind of infrastructure, it is unlikely to be able to support the growth of a virtual currency as you're discussing.
Other views, similar?
I agree.
Yeah, I think the example of Kenya is a great one. Kenya is a country where more people have access to smartphones than to running water. And, the telecom companies stepped up and saw that there was a need, that the existing banking infrastructure was not meeting the needs of the people. And so the telecoms built a mobile payment system in Kenya that today represents 30% of the GDP of Kenya. It's done by people sending text messages on their cell phone.
And I guess, Mr. Clippy, I want to just make an editorial comment. I agree with you. We got to get this balance right. We want to keep this innovation in America. But as a former governor, the revenue leakage from internet-based transactions for states that depend upon a sales tax is an enormous challenge. So we've got to get this balance right. That is one of our challenges going forward. I guess I want to press as well with Senator Heller's comments. We have thought about, and Ms. Tunstall, you commented about some of these other competing virtual currencies. I think about a few years back when Second Life was going to be all the rage and everybody was going to have an avatar and we're going to trade on that. It seems, though, that the Bitcoin currency, that my understanding has now got about 90% of the folks who are not users but actually investors, rather than users, at some point, do you think that one of these currencies will emerge and Bitcoin seems to be going down that path, or do you think there'll always be that threat that other currencies, and again, I think particularly your comments about one that tries to fit within the legal regime?
So I think it's more, unless Bitcoin makes some big changes that allow the Silk Road type situation to stop from happening, I don't see how it will become commercially viable in the United States. And I'd like to, you mentioned Second Life, I'd like to mention that actually in Second Life, I looked at for a client, they wanted to brand the banks in Second Life and be the bank in Second Life. And as I looked at it, the way that the law works, even if it's in a virtual world. If the bank is doing the transactions, the U.S. banking laws apply. And so that was a very interesting result. And what's fascinating about virtual currency, actually, is that it has found a way to fall through what our infrastructure is right now for financial regulation, which is why we do need to have some kind of framework put around it.
I would just, my time's going to run out. I would simply say, though, that because of some of the illicit activities and because of perhaps the interest of some of the folks who want to do this off the grid or not be controlled by the central banking system, or we've got to get this balance. We've got to sort through this right. I'd also make mention, Mr. Chairman, that as a politician who had a Second Life avatar, that got me attention for a nanosecond. But
Mr. Chairman, thank you. Just take this a different direction and just use my little time to tell a little story about when I used to regulate truth in advertising, and I couldn't get my advertisers to tell the truth, and so I told them they could tell, put whatever they wanted in an ad, but I was going to take out a full-page ad right next to theirs saying, I don't regulate them. I don't regulate them, buyer beware. And we're really at that point, because the more we legitimize this in regulation, the more we commercialize it. And so how do we strike that balance? And I'm interested in the academic point of view and maybe the legal point of view. How do we strike that balance? Because to me, if we get involved in regulation, we legitimize it as a true opportunity.
Well, I think that there's a lot to what you say, Senator, that if we regulate, we do legitimize. And some of today's witnesses have talked about trust, and trust is a very important factor, particularly with financial products and services. So there is that risk. There is a bone in my body that says, I think that's a risk worth taking. And I think it's particularly worth taking as we think of this, these virtual currencies, as having functions that are a lot like credit cards or debit cards in some respects.
But wouldn't you agree that right now, without any form of intervention, without legitimizing it, every buyer out there has to be careful, and that has restricted or limited or tapped down the willingness of people to participate. And you really are, it's kind of ironic because we want all the free enterprise system, but the regulatory scheme and saying I've adapted to the regulatory scheme buys you the opportunity to participate in the market in a way that other financial institutions participate.
I couldn't agree more. I think that there is, in my prepared statement, I make the observation that right now it looks like all the risks fall on the users.
And what's wrong with that?
Well, that's why maybe we're not seeing the growth that we would see if there was a bigger structure around it and greater clarity in that structure. But if people want to do their business that way,
But we just tell them, you go ahead, do your business that way, but we aren't responsible, and we'll deal with sales tax consequences. We'll work through those issues in terms of value for value transfer, because you can deal a barter to barter. I mean, people can barter, and you still can do an analysis. You can do an analysis on what, in fact, is the capital gains or the short-term or long-term capital gains, and just try and adapt on a case-by-case basis the existing regulation without legitimizing. I'm interested in your point of view, Ms. Tunstall.
So my perspective on that is it's an analogy to social media, where a number of companies have decided to kind of stick their head in the sand and say, we're not going to engage in social media, and then the company sucks.com gets founded, and then somebody sets up a fake Facebook page and pretends to be that company, and that company loses significant reputation when they choose to stick their head in the sand and not engage and not pay attention to what's happening. And so my concern with not getting into regulating this area and being interested in what happens here is that it could eventually affect our financial system's reputation.
No, I understand that. But my point is, frequently in these situations, we think about how we're going to fix it or facilitate it, when maybe we should just leave it alone. And maybe that's the approach that we need to think about and warn people, you're on your own.
So, and I think from a consumer perspective and from a user perspective, I think that was a very good comment, that that is where we are. And I think that that's a very fair point.
Mm-hmm. Well, we are all left with a lot of questions. We're going to turn to Senator Schumer. But first, I just want to note, we'll follow up on some of those questions, the separation of the payment system from the banking system. Professor Hughes, your thoughts about how you avoid the boom and bust cycle that's inherent in Bitcoin, where it's both a speculatory instrument as well as a payment system. And, of course, we're all absolutely enthralled to find out exactly what Senator Warner's avatar looked like. And with that, we're going to turn to Senator Schumer. Welcome.
I, for one, don't want to see what Senator Warner's avatar looked like. Anyway, I want to thank Chairman Merkley and Warner for letting us have this hearing and allowing me to participate. I've been very interested in this issue. I have a somewhat different approach than Senator Heitkamp. A while back, as you know, I called on federal authorities to shut down the website Silk Road, which they recently did. Many people interpreted my action at the time as directed at Bitcoin, because Bitcoin was the sole method of payment on Silk Road, and assume that I also wanted to shut down or stamp out Bitcoin. That is not the case. I do not want to shut down or stamp out Bitcoin. New York sits in many ways at the nexus of all the issues being discussed today. As financial capital, the potential for creation of a new payment platform and the rise of alternative currencies could have profound and exciting implications for the way we conduct financial transactions. As a rapidly growing hub for technology and VC, venture capital, New York has every interest in building on the promise that technologies like Bitcoin have to revolutionize payment systems or even form the building blocks for whole new technology platforms. But all of that promise is threatened by the association of virtual currencies with criminal activities, from purchasing illicit goods and services to money laundering. If Bitcoin continues to attract attention, mostly as a way to finance purchases on websites like Silk Road, it's going to find itself in a digital wasteland. So in order for the legitimate uses of technology like Bitcoin to flourish, it's imperative that its susceptibility to illicit uses be addressed. There must be a way to separate the wheat from the chaff. So, bottom line is very simple. I would ask Mr. Galippi.
Yes.
I would ask Mr. Galippi, do you have any specific suggestions of how we'd separate the wheat from the chaff? What would you suggest to the witnesses on panel one to ensure that we address legitimate law enforcement concerns without duly inhibiting the development of these promising new technologies? Mr. Galippi.
Yes. Thank you, Senator Schumer. So I think you have to first understand that there's multiple parts of Bitcoin. There is the low-level protocol, which are the bits and bytes that make it work, and then there's the application and service layer that businesses and consumers can engage in. And this is typically where you find businesses like mine operating. So when you want to try to separate the legitimate uses from the illegitimate ones, you know, clearly, you know, the point to do that are by the visible service providers like ourselves, like BitPay. You know, we have over 12,000 businesses using our service to accept Bitcoin, and we have a very strict know your customer policy to make sure that we know every merchant, you know, who they are and what they're selling, because we only want the legitimate and good actors using our service. The bad guys are going to try to figure it out how to do it on their own. But it shows you with the recent arrest of the guy from Silk Road that just because you use Bitcoin doesn't mean that you can evade law enforcement, right? They caught the guy. He's in jail. So
took long enough.
Yeah. So I think there's a lot of effort, and services like ours and others are willing to work with regulators to make sure that what we do complies with the rules, because we all share in the same and common goal to protect consumers from fraud and to prevent the bad actors from using the system.
Right. And I'm sure you've thought about this because you realize the danger of Silk Road type actors have to this appropriate new way of payment. Do you have any specific suggestions? And if you don't, if you'd like to try to spend a little time thinking them up and sending them to us, I know the record probably, Mr. Chairman, will remain open for a week. That would be helpful.
Yeah, I'd be happy to do that.
Okay. Other witnesses in answer to my specific question? Anyone have any thoughts? Ms. Tunstall.
Yes. I think that a very good point was made by Mr. Galippi, and that is that the face to the user is the point to catch the transaction.
Mm-hmm.
So very similar to the internet gambling restrictions that are in place. I would actually be curious, do you screen against merchant codes for internet gambling as a credit card processor would do?
Yeah, correct. We don't allow that.
So that type of approach for, you know, for tagging the transactions and knowing what the parties are, you can still be anonymous as long as it's a transaction between an individual and this this company for a purchase. So we do have some existing controls and examples that can help on this side.
Good. Well, I'd again be interested in your submitting the specifics in writing. Any of the other witnesses? My time's up, so...
I would just say that while I think Mr. Galippi deserves a lot of credit for creating the company that he created with the kinds of controls he created, I would question if that is applicable across the industry and whether there are things we can do to make sure that the kinds of mitigations and controls that he's put in place are applicable to all in that business.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Okay. Well, thank you all very much, and I hope you will submit some specific suggestions and in Mr. Galippi in detail about what you've been able to do, so we might be able to parlay that to other companies, although, as Mr. Smoser says, we may not be able to do it in certain places. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you very much, Senator Schumer, and thank you to all of our witnesses, and thank you, Co-Chair Warner. We will, in fact, keep the record open for additional questions for 7 days. And this concludes the meeting of the Subcommittee on National Security, International Trade and Finance, and the Subcommittee on Economic Policy.
Thank you. Today, the Wall Street Journal.